Here's an image I want to copy stuff from. I want to create the vertical launch system and then add it to my ship in this bow area here. So I will start by creating a cube. And by the way, I did add the background image. It's saved from my browser as a .jfef for whatever reason, but I wasn't able to import it into Blender. So if that ever happens to you, it still worked as a JPEG. So I renamed the file .jpg and then dragged it in and it worked into Blender. Let's scale this to the appropriate size. So I'm going for a very rough sizing right now because I know that my 3D printing won't be totally accurate. So I'm not too concerned about scale. I just want a representation. I will go a bit higher than it would be in real life because I need to exaggerate the scale of things when I'm creating things to be 3D printed just so that the different layers have space to be interpolated. Now I'll create another cube for one of these hatches. And let's make it separately so that we have enough room to copy it as an array modifier later. I'll show that later, but for right now we need to have one perfect example of a hatch. I'll start with the easy things. I know that the shape is kind of beveled around, so I do Control B and bevel it to about the size that I think it should be. And then we'll add a couple of cubes that'll represent the hinges. So let's go down here and scale this to the appropriate width and height. Of course, I'm still going for something very representational and not necessarily something very accurate. Just something that conveys the meaning at a relatively okay viewing distance. So I think that when the layers interpolate, this will work well. And we should also be able to, I noticed that in my my Booltron, whenever I add things that are exactly along the edges of a mesh, it doesn't work so well. So for as an example, if I have this edge and that edge colliding, and I do a union, as you can see, it removed the object. If I go more like this, choose a union, then it actually merges them together. So it seems to be some sort of issue, or I don't know if I'd really call it a bug, but really something to consider. You need to kind of offset your objects just a little bit when you're trying to merge them together. And again, the reason you would do that is that inside Cura, or I guess other slicers, it's only the outside of the mesh that counts. And in Cura, it's going to be the insides of the mesh will be deleted when they intersect that way. So you don't want that to happen. And what that is called is having a watertight mesh. So your mesh needs to look as though it could hold water without having points where it would delete itself or converge over itself in weird ways. So I'm doing Shift D to duplicate our work and adding the second one roughly here. And then I'm going to select all of these and do a union of those. So now we have our shape that we want for the hatch. And then I'm going to add a new, actually we won't add anything new. We'll first of all merge this to the base. We're doing this, I'll add it. And remember, as I said, we want to offset our parts. So I'm adding it here, just I know that it's a bit offset and not exactly flat on the surface, but that's what I want. Now what we'll do is duplicate our work. So we'll do an array modifier. And first I'm going to do a count 2 is good. I'm going to do 0 on the x-axis. And 1.2 I think would be good on the y-axis. Now the thing we'll notice is that it needs to rotate. So instead of doing it on the y-axis as I was planning to, let's do it on the x-axis, 1.2, and have it multiplied by 4. Then I'll do 1.15. That looks closer together. And then we'll do Shift D for a duplicate, and then Y. Make sure it only goes on the y-axis. Then I'll do a rotate 180, and then grab Y. And bring that here. And if you wanted to accurately move it, I would just select the snapping feature, grab X, and then snap it to that line. So these two would be exactly correct based on each other. And then shift tab is the shortcut to turn snapping on and off. Then I'd grab Y, bring it closer together. So now that we have the shape, we can more easily tell how to center this rectangle. So let's go around here. And I'm just doing this visually because I know accuracy is not important right now. And now scale on the y-axis with everything selected. That looks roughly correct. And then I think there should be some sort of bevel, at least on the top edge. So I'll do Alt. Not working right now. Okay, for whatever reason, it's not wanting to select the top edge. But yeah, select the... Oh, sorry. Control Z to remove. Shift click to continue selecting more. And then we'll do Control B for bevel. And with my scroll wheel, I'll control the amount of bevel. I don't necessarily need a lot. It's just bevel along the edge here. Okay, this is looking roughly good. And should be accurate for 3D print as well. I will extend the bottom, I believe, of this. Just a little bit, so that we can place the kind of supports that are on the edge here. For that, I'm going to create a new cube, and then scale it down, then move it to about here, and then what we're going to do is bring it down and grab here, and then I'll do Control R for a loop cut, because I think that this goes on two heights, and then we'll do E for extrude and do kind of a stair step. And this should be the shape that we need for our elements. I think that's good. I think it's a little bit exaggerated in size, but it still needs to have a certain mass to be able to be 3D printed. So let's duplicate this. Bring it quite close to the bottom, and then add a modifier, which is of course an array modifier. And let's count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we can duplicate them 9 times. And then with the relative offset, I just have to scale this outwards and then center it visually. Okay, so as I'm working on it, I'm noticing it looks pretty good. But I do think that it could be a little less wide, so I'm going to select the space, shift, and then grab X. Make these a little less prominent. And then we're going to scale it outwards again. And then grab X. This should be centered, and I'm thinking it looks a lot more balanced. What you can do if you want to make sure to rotate things accurately, and I know I'm not going to really change this, I'll hit apply. This will apply the modifier, and then I'll do origin to center of mass volume. That's going to put the origin in the middle. So now I know that if I do shift D, which is to duplicate, Y, and then rotate 180, it's going to rotate from the middle and not from the origin, which would have been here originally. And now I can just... Actually, they're perfectly placed, it looks like. Yep, looks good to me. So all I can do now, shift D again, rotate 90, grab, place it here, and count how many there are, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So in this case, I'll go in wireframe view and select 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay. And select, X, delete vertices, here we go. And then go from the top view, center our work again. This is looking about right. Grab X just to bring it to the edge. And then remember the origin trick. So origin to center of mass volume. Shift D, X, rotate 180. When I say rotate, that means R. And then we're gonna go in right frame view and bring this in. Here we go. Now we have our whole part. So now we can start joining things together. You might want to keep an original if you want to continue editing, but I'm confident enough that this looks good right now, so I'm going to do a union of everything. Let's do a union, and let's look if the wireframe seems reasonable. Okay, I think it's looking good. I think it's looking like everything is normal. And if I go look inside, I can see that everything is a negative shape, which is perfect for what I want for 3D printing. So let's go now to these. And these, I believe, are also correct. If I'm unmistaken, yep, these are perfectly good shapes. So if we look at the vertex mode, if I just grab Z temporarily and look at these, it should be that if I'm in vertex mode, yeah, I grab this vertex and it's alone. There are not two vertices in this one's place. So that's what I want. I'll do Control Z until I go back to the normal place I wanted. And then we're going to apply the array. Go here. Apply. Just to avoid any problems, and then we're going to union these with the base. And now, instead of seeing doubles, we should see, yep, I see that everything is joined. And if I go inside the object, I should be seeing that the top face of the rectangle has been removed and been replaced by the negative shapes of the covers. So this is looking good. Now all that's left to do is to scale it properly and bring it into Cura. So, by the way, if you want to see that all vertices are connected, you can do Control L, and it should select the whole shape. If vertices were not connected, but part of the same object, for example, if we had a cube here, and I did join, and I do a Control L, you'll see that because these vertices are not connected, it's not part of the shape, even though it's considered a whole object, because it's joined together with the rest of the mesh. And that would create problems. That in a 3D print does not work out. So yeah, let's drag it in and scale it down. I like scaling the vertices instead of scaling the whole object, by the way, because I don't have to do an apply scale, which in my experience sometimes causes issues, but it's not always been a big deal. So I think that I have reference images back here. Yeah, if I go in wireframe view, I'm kind of seeing the original size. So that'll save me a whole lot of effort because all I have to do now is scale this to the appropriate measurement. And you notice I go outside of edit mode to move. And that's because whenever you move, you're moving all the vertices relative. If you're in edit mode, you move all the vertices relative to the origin. Whereas if you're in object mode, you move the origin itself. So I want to keep the origin in the center of my object. That's why I'm doing that. So this should be correct. Roughly the right scale. As you can see, I approximated it. But it's not exactly the same shape, and I honestly don't really care. It's not something that anybody will see. So now we'll go to File, and then Export, SDL. And here I have my VLS. Let's do model 1, or let's call it something else. I have 8, so I'll call it VLS times 8 because there are 8 covers. And make sure that it's selection only. Export SDL. And now we can go in Cura and find our SDL, which is, should be called VLS. Yeah, right down here. Then copy that into Cura. Check whether the scale is correct, which it does not seem to be in this place. I think that it's scaled. Mine typically goes to 1000. That depends on how you have your blender set up and all. But I'll multiply this. So multiply selected model times 3 to have 4 copies. Control Z, I want to first rotate it. So let's rotate it on the Z-axis, and then move it so that it fits in with other models, right? Yeah, like this should be good. And then I can hit multiply. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, multiply by 5. I don't know why I brought it over there. I brought two of them over there. So we'll have to resort to placing these by hand. Which is fine. Software these days. They don't make it as they used to. Technically, software is always improving. Okay, so yeah. And I'm going to try to align these parts as closely as I can, just to avoid stringing as much as possible. It'll still occur, but what I mean is there will be fewer, shorter strings, and I think overall for a printer it's easier to print things when they're closer together. It's hard to know where the extrusions will occur that align to each other, so I'm just making a guess. It's not all that important. If you wanted a more beautiful model, you'd have to print one at once. Okay, then we'll do slice. As you'll remember, I have everything on ultra fine. I do also have an infill. It's set to 15%, which is okay, but the best infill is cubic subdivision. That's the strongest one, from what I hear. There we go. And now you can see that all the shapes work out very well because there's no surface that's diagonal, except for the bevels here. And the reason I did that is just because it really shows a lot of the extrusions, you know, the spaghetti noodles, they show through if you have an angled surface. They show through a lot. And when I paint and everything, it's not so beautiful. So I prefer to have a shape that's rather flat, but when I paint it, it's going to kind of fill the crevices a little bit, and the shadows of these objects will be exaggerated because the cells are quite high, and that'll visually create the shape that I want at a normal viewing distance from the model without being ugly. So that's it. That's how you'd go about it.